Today I'm going to talk a lot about Spring, a lot about Mongo, and how to build high performance applications leveraging these two technologies. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a Java software engineer. I'm working on the Java projects for more than 13 years. I have been teaching Java. I have been a consultant and architect in various software companies. And because I love Spring, I get Spring certified professional. And most currently, I'm working at VMware in the area of cloud management and cloud automation. The agenda for today, I'll begin with a very short overview of Mongo. How many of you have used Mongo in real time or student projects? Good. And how many of you have used Spring Data? Good. Quite a lot of people. At the end, we will build a self-service catalog application, which is an example that will demonstrate how to use Mongo and Spring Data together. So what is Mongo? Mongo is open source database created in 2007 by a company called 10gen. Now the company is renamed and is called MongoDB. Mongo is a document-oriented database, which means that it stores documents. It uses JSON format, which means that documents that are stored into the database can have different fields that change from document to document, and that allows to change the document structure very easily when the requirements are changing. Mongo is very easy to use with applications that follow object-oriented design, just because it uses JSON, and JSON very easily maps to objects, and you don't need layers like object relational mapping. It is written in C++. It has ad hoc queries, indexing, and real-time support, and real-time aggregation support. And like most of the non-SQL databases, it is a distributed database, which means that you can install the database on multiple servers and scale it very easily. So according to the DB Engine website, the Mongo is rated to be the fifth most popular database in 2017. The first four are all SQL databases, so Mongo is in fact the most popular non-SQL database nowadays. Last year it was fourth, now it's fifth, so probably it wasn't a good year for Mongo guys, but hopefully the next year it will go up. The key features of Mongo. First, MongoDB is very high performance database. It has full support for indexes and dynamic queries, which allows to get the data that you need very fast. Also, it supports embedded documents. There is no joins in Mongo. And this also increased the performance because it reduces the I/O activity on the disk. As I already said, Mongo has very rich query language. It has data aggregation, text search, and geospatial queries. It is almost like a SQL database in terms of query support. Everything that you can do with queries on SQL database can do with Mongo as well. MongoDB is has high availability. It has automatic failover and data redundancy. This is something very important, especially when we compare non-SQL databases to relational databases. For example, if we need to provide high availability on a Postgres SQL, it takes 3 months for two engineers to implement it. And on MongoDB, it comes out of the box. regular engineers. In VMware, it took 2 weeks, but yeah, but it was made by very experienced engineers. By engineers which every day do only this. Another very nice features of Mongo is that it scales horizontally very easily. It has a concept called sharding that distributes the data across multiple machines. And in Mongo 4, it also has support for zones. And zones are useful when you want to isolate a specific set of data on a particular data sets and the data servers. And also when you want to route specific requests to a particular database servers so that you get better performance. And third but not least, Mongo zones also allow you to place the data closest to the application servers that consumed the data. Mongo has support for multiple storage engines, which means that you can easily write and plug a storage engine into MongoDB. The current available storage engines are Wild Tiger, which is the default engine for Mongo 3.4. The old engine that was used is MMAP version 1. And also there is in-memory engine, which allows to store data in memory. When it comes to the CAP theorem, Mongo stands between consistency and partition tolerance, which means that it provides a consistency and partition tolerance, but it may fail when there is a failing node. But as I said, there is automatic failover. And that failure will very short will be recovered very shortly in very small amount of time but there will be a failure. Why to use MongoDB? For me, Mongo is very simple to learn. It is very easy to build applications with it. It uses JSON notation to store documents, which very naturally map to the object-oriented programming model. It is schemaless, which means that our application can evolve easily when the requirement change, because we don't have schema constraints on the database. And also, when our application needs more database power, we can easily scale Mongo across multiple distributed data centers with no downtime. For what MongoDB is great for? It is general purpose database, so it can be used as a replacement of any relational database for web applications, for most of the cases. It is very good for use cases like single view. Single view applications collect data from multiple sources and then visualize that data on a single page, which usually consists of multiple widgets, and each widget knows how to present data from different documents. Another very common use case is Internet of Things. Each year, more than 40 billion sensors are being sold. And these sensors communicate between each other. They send a lot of data. And that data is very easily stored in MongoDB. And then you can analyze it very quickly. And when you need more storage, you can scale it very fast. Another use case is real-time analytics. Thanks to the search, to the text search that comes with MongoDB and the aggregation support and also the MapReduce support, it allows to create applications that build dynamic queries, and these queries provide results very fast because they're evaluated on the server side on MongoDB from MongoDB engine, and the response of the data that we analyze is very, very good. Another kind of applications that use Mongo is catalog applications. When you have a catalog, you want to store various kind of data. Some of the data may come from the financial services, another may come from production. Also, it may come from customers, from different customers, and you want to have everything in one place. Another use case is a content management system. Mongo can store different type of documents. It supports binary storage. So it is very appropriate for content management systems because there is no schema. You can store any kind of documents, and you can scale the database very easily when you need more space and storage. What is MongoDB not great for? Well, it is not great when we have a highly transactional application. For example, if we have a booking system and the booking engine uses Mongo, it won't be a good choice. Also, if we have an internet banking application, it won't be a good choice to use MongoDB as well. If there is an application which is very old and it is built around relational data model and SQL, it is also not recommended to rebuild to use MongoDB in place of the relational database, because it will be very hard to rewrite that application. Compared to the relational database, here is a table that explains Mongo concepts and SQL database concepts. So there is database term in Mongo as well. The analog for a table in Vue is a collection. For row is a document. The document can be a JSON format or BJSON, which is the binary format. The column is represented by a field. Index is, again, index. The join is represented by embedded documents. There is no join in MongoDB. When we need to combine different documents, we can embed one document into another, or we can reference one document. The foreign key is reference in Mongo. And partition in the relational database management systems is shard in Mongo. This is the Mongo document model. There is ID, which is internal. Even if we don't provide ID, MongoDB will create one and will use it as a primary key. There is types in Mongo document. There is string, integer. There is array. There aren't joins, so we need to have nested documents. And also, Mongo has support for geospatial coordinates. We will see example with geospatial coordinates later.
One question.
Yes?
Regarding the nested document, is MongoDB going to create implicit ID? Like you said, that the ID is automatically generated.
No.
What about the nested document?
No, for embedded document, no, because it is part of the parent document, and we don't need ID.
Okay, thank you.
That was the short overview about Mongo. It is very basic, but it is needed in order to understand the self-service catalog application that we will build at the end of this talk. So, Spring Data. Spring Data is umbrella project that simplifies persisting of POJOs to various forms of storage. There is Spring Data for JPA, there is Spring Data for MongoDB, there is Spring Data for Redis, there is Spring Data for Cassandra. There are four concepts that Spring Data provides. There is repository, which converts the retrieved data into POSH objects, and also the other way, from POSH objects into saved data. There is mapping, which can be inferred from conventions, and also we can use annotations to help the mapping, and when you want to customize that mapping. There is a template, which is implementation of the template pattern, and hides the complexity of the database driver. And there is also a query. Spring Data provides support for native queries, and also provides a query DSL that we can use to build dynamic queries and also have type safety. The key features of Spring Data MongoDB are that it provides configuration support for Mongo, including support for Mongo replica sets. This is how MongoDB scales. It provides a Mongo template, which is analog to the JDBC template and JPA template for those who have used a relational database with Spring Data. And the repository support provides support for native queries. It also provides automatic implementation of the interfaces that we write. And there is also annotation based mapping for Mongo specifically. There are a few important annotations. These are document, ID, field, index, text index. There is a geo index, and so on. We will see it later. And some additional features which are very useful. Spring Data MongoDB provides exception translation into Spring's portable data access exception. This is very important when we need to handle the exceptions. It has feature-rich object mapping. It provides persistence and mapping lifecycle events. Very often, when we want to save a document, we want to put a date field, which keeps the time when we created the document for the first time. And this is achieved through lifecycle listeners, which are listening for these lifecycle events. Another example is also when we want to keep who is modifying the document. This is another string field into the document, which keeps the username, for example, that modifies the document. There is a Java-based query, criteria, and also native queries. There is also support for cross-storage. It is possible to have a JPA entity, and some of the fields of the JPA entity can reference a document in MongoDB. And it also provides geospatial integration, which is very popular nowadays. And now the interesting stuff. We are going to build a self-service catalog application using Spring Data REST, which will help us to build a RESTful application. Here is how a self-service catalog looks like. This is a kind of catalog that allows to request different items from the catalog. In this example, you can request virtual machines, but it also can provide support for requesting other kind of resources, for example, equipment, or even you can request a coffee, for example. This is how a typical request would look. Here the example is a request for vSphere machine, which has CentOS on it. This is the sample application that I have prepared in advance. And because I'm an application developer, I don't care too much about UI. And I care more about the backend part. Now I will show you how we can build self-service catalog using MongoDB. Only on the backend. The UI for now is not so important. So this is the data model. We have a catalog item which represents the entity that we want to request from the catalog. It is annotated with the document annotation. The document is stored into the collection called catalog item. The collection is analog of a table. There is ID, which is the same as JPA entity, for example. There is index. There is text index, which is used when we want to have a full text search. Here, the request field is another class, which represents the fields that we need to provide data for in order to request the catalog item. These fields can vary from catalog item to catalog item. So in this case, Mongo is very suitable because we don't have schema. And we can have catalog items that can be requested in different ways. It could accept different fields from different types. And also we have a provider for the catalog item. It could be some virtual infrastructure service, or it could be some a service that provides equipment, or it could be a service that provides a coffee. For the catalog provider, we're using DB reference annotations, which means that we don't want the catalog provider to be embedded into the catalog item document. We just want to have a reference to the provider. so that when we request the catalog item, we know which provider to call in order to do the provisioning of the virtual machine, for example, if we are provisioning a machine. And the catalog provider document, it has ID, it has name, and it has location. In order to make queries for geolocation, we need to index the location field with geospatial index. There are also different types of index that we will see later. And now I will run this application, and if I'm working enough, I will get Chrome. Okay, good. Yes.
When we have data.
Yeah, when we have data, I will zoom. I have created two repositories, which are exported as REST resources. The first repository is querying catalog items. So I call it catalog item repository, and the path that is used in order to be accessed is catalog items. And the other repository is a catalog item provider repository. They both extend the Mongo repository, which provides also basic CRUD operations like save, find all, insert, and so on. It extends paging and sorting repository, which provides paging and sorting out of the box. And it also extends CRUD repository, which provides the basic CRUD operations. Here is the MongoDB configuration. Because this is a sample project, we have a very simple configuration. We have a class which is annotated with the configuration annotation. We have a special annotation, enable Mongo repositories, which specifies where is the repositories that query Mongo documents. And we also have to create the Mongo client. Mongo client is abstraction that creates the Mongo driver. And it accepts the parameters like localhost, port. Also, if there is authentication required, we can pass username and password. Also, if you want to have a high availability, we can set replica sets in this Mongo client. And the other two classes are traditional configuration classes that we need in order to initialize a traditional web application built with Spring. This class initializes the MVC framework, the Spring MVC framework, and the application initializer brings up the Spring context.
So, can you see it now? Okay. So we have two repositories exported. One is catalog items, It's empty because we don't have any data into the database. So here I have created a test that initializes the database very quickly so that we don't lose time. If I go back to the catalog items URL, now we can see that we have three catalog items: vSphere machine, Amazon machine, and Azure machine. We have a description, we have a cost, how much does it cost to provision a machine in vSphere. We have fields that we need to populate when we are requesting the catalog item. In the case of vSphere machine, it is a CPU, memory, and storage. And also, we have a provider of this catalog item, and because it is defined as a DB reference, we can see it is another query that is made, and we have the data for the provider of vSphere machine. We have name and location. And for the other catalog items, we have a different set of request fields, because for Amazon, we need different inputs. And for Azure, we need, again, different inputs. That's why we have image and size in Azure machine. If you want to search, we need to define a search queries into the repository. There are multiple queries that I already defined. The first three are using the convention that Spring provides. It uses the name of the method in order to construct the query that is executed into the database. The first query is searches for all catalog items by name. The second searches for all catalog items starting with a given parameter name. And the third is a query that searches for catalog items starting with a given name and also ordered by cost. So let's try them. They're automatically exported behind the search path. Find all by name, the first one. Let's find all by name. Machine. Okay, let's take the exact name. Okay, that's the risks of the live demo. Yeah, it. Okay, let me see again the query, but. Get all by name, find all by name. Okay, it should work. Yes, maybe. Yes, it's because of the quotes. So the next query is find all that starts with. Again, I'll use only vSphere. And we have the vSphere machine. If I use Amazon, we see Amazon machine. And the third party is start with and order by cost. So start with A. We have two catalog items, Amazon machine. And it is ordered by cost. Oops, sorry, I didn't use the right. So yeah, now we can see that we have the cheapest one first. We can also have native queries when we create queries, which is very important because Mongo database has very rich query support and there are a lot of things that are not supported by Spring Data. The first one is analog of the find by name query, which is the first query that we tried. But the second is not very well supported in Spring Data, and we can easily write text search and use a native MongoDB query. So let's try it. Oops, I need to provide query string. Provide search string, yes. Machine, for example. And we can see that, yeah, we have everything. But if I search only for Amazon, we have only one. And the last query that I want to show you is the query that searches providers that are closer to us. So this is the native query that we need to write in order to search by geo-coordinates. Providers, now I'll provide the coordinates for one for the first catalog for the first provider. So the result are two providers, infrastructure service software and infrastructure service Paris. And this is because of the max distance that I have provided in the query. So this is example of how we can create queries which search by geospatial coordinates. And basically, that was the example. Here are some references. The MongoDB documentation is very well written, so you can do almost everything only using the MongoDB documentation. The Spring data is also very good, but it is not as much complete as Mongo documentation, but it is also good. So if we start writing projects in Spring data and Mongo, these are the two sites that you need to start from. And that was all from me. Questions? Yeah.
The first question is, you mentioned that there is a possibility for the mappings of the objects that we export to the MongoDB to make convection inferred mappings.
Yes.
Can you give us an example about that?
Mongo has built-in support for the core types that exists in Java, and the types that exist in MongoDB. Also, here when we have, for example, location, it is array of decimal, but it is automatically mapped as geospatial coordinates. And also, we can have a custom conversion mapping, so that we can.
Yes, that's really my question: how we can customize it if we want to.
There is a way that we can customize it, and basically we need to implement interfaces provided by Spring Mongo, Spring Data Mongo. And once we provide the implementation of the converter interface, we need to register that implementation into the Mongo template. By the way, Mongo template is used from repositories as well, but it is implicit. Because there is, when we configure Mongo in Spring Data, there are three important objects, let's say. The first one is the creation of the Mongo driver. The next one is the creation of the Mongo template. And the third one is the initialization of the repositories. So when we created the Mongo template, we can register converters so that when we are doing queries, it doesn't matter whether we use Mongo template or Mongo repository. We have all the converters that are registered.
Okay. And the other question is, because I noticed that there is also a possibility for text search, Is it possible to make something like a multi-term, multi-field text search in which each term, each search word might be matched in a different field?
Multi-term? I'm not sure. Compared to the possibilities of the Elasticsearch, for example, is that the question? Yeah, basically. Yeah, compared to the possibilities that we have in the Elasticsearch, the text search in Mongo is more limited. But again, it is good enough for doing basic analytics. And maybe it will evolve with the time. Yeah. Yes.
So I have never touched MongoDB in my life, so it's a question related entirely to MongoDB. So let's imagine that we have three documents, and document A have a reference to document B, and document B have a reference to document C. So they're just linked in this way. If we perform a full text search, and we have three words, but each of these words, the first word is mentioned in the first document, the second word is mentioned in the second document, the third word is mentioned in a third document. So what is going to be the exact result that we are going to get from this full text search? Are we going to get all the three documents, or what?
Good question. I haven't tried exactly this. I think no, it will probably get the first one, but I'm not sure.
Okay, I'll give it a try. Thank you.
I'll give it a try. Other questions?
So the question is, can you convert an existing embedded document to a reference? Because usually you start with something simple, like the address, or I don't know what it was, but in your presentation. And it turns out that later you need this address for something else. And it makes sense at that point to be a DB ref. But you already have a lot of records made with the embedded one. You can add a new field that is using the other one, but it's becoming a mess. So how you actually fix the data? That's the more or less the...
You can very easily fix the data because there is no structure in the Mongo document. So you can create a script or whatever you need to go over each document. And for each embedded document, create another document and put a reference to it. So there is no automatic mechanism, but we can very easily write the logic for doing this.
So it's not like based on the data that you are inserting, it's creating a mapping that cannot be changed. It's more like there is no internal mapping that is stored. Because I remember that in Elastic, there is a mapping that is basically generated based on the data, kind of, and some other rules. But this mapping stays, like you have to live with it. It's again a JSON, but it's a different JSON. You are saying that basically I can rename the field and make a new document and then basically make the new field with the same old name, but this time double ref, and it's okay.
Yeah. In fact, you need to just to update the document with extracting the embedded document and putting a reference for that field. Now there is no automatic mechanism. Other questions? You can have a dynamic model as well. You can have a map, for example, and you can Yeah, and you can store JSON there as well. Also, there are in Java, maybe it is not easy, but for other languages like Go, which are dynamic, and dynamic languages will definitely benefit more from a database which has no schema. But here, I can give you one particular example. We have a static model, but we can have many fields which have just strings and store JSON. And when they are stored into the Mongo database, they are stored as one complete JSON document. So in that way, you can leverage dynamic data. You can make the data dynamic.